So you think you're on the road to a secure retirement? Well, so did Steve and Linda.
The volatility of the stock market has made things very difficult. One of the things I worry about is how long that will last.
Up next on MoneyTrack, how to set a course for a comfortable and happy retirement.
MoneyTrack is made possible by the Investor Protection Trust. The Investor Protection Trust is a nonprofit organization devoted to investor education. Over half of all Americans are now invested in the securities markets, making investor education and protection vitally important. Since 1993, the Investor Protection Trust has worked with states across the country to provide the independent, objective investor education needed by all Americans to make informed investment decisions.
This is MoneyTrack with Pam Kruger and Jack Gallagher. Bringing you real stories and real experts to show you what works and what doesn't work when it comes to investing your money. This is MoneyTrack.
Hi, everybody. Welcome to MoneyTrack. I'm Pam Kruger.
And I'm Jack Gallagher. And yes, we're that TV show about money and investing that just happens to have a dog on the show. Who sort of wanders in and out of all of our shots. Remind me again why she's here.
Because the show's about real people.
That's
and
right.
Real people have dogs. Instead of coming from Wall Street, our approach to investing comes from your street. Because when it's all said and done, isn't it really just about lifestyle?
Very true. And maintaining a nice lifestyle, especially into retirement, which is a great segue because your retirement is our topic today.
Now, Jack and I are standing on the deck of what's considered one of the most expensive waterfront properties any place in the world.
These are multi-million dollar views of the San Francisco Bay, the Golden Gate Bridge, and yes, real people actually live inside that house. I saw them in there.
Did you?
Yes.
Imagine being retired and calling this home. I mean, that would be amazing. There are lots of beautiful places where you could live out what you hope are going to be your incredibly pleasant leisure years. The Bay Area is just one.
Now, if you watch us on a regular basis, you know that we'd like to feature real people who are representative of most of America. Maybe they earn $40,000, $50,000 a year because we figure, hey, if you live in one of these places, you have already made it.
But recently, we ran across a very well-off couple who live in another gorgeous spot on the other coast. And let me tell you, they make a lot of money.
Yes, and we want to share their story because of what we can learn from this couple as they edge closer to retirement. Plus, to be honest with you, we're just nosy. Our MoneyTrack correspondent, N.D. Walton, is going to introduce us to Steve and Linda. You're going to get to know them a little bit, and then we're going to come back and talk about them. A little gossip about Steve and Linda. You like that.
There are a lot of ways to navigate a trip. You can ask someone for directions, use a simple map, or hey, you could just wing it. But these are complicated times, and complicated times call for a more strategic approach.
Meet the Adams, Steve and Linda, a couple that clearly knows where they want to go, smoothly and happily into retirement. Trouble is, they don't know the best route. On the outside, they appear to have it all. Lovely home, nice cars. In fact, most people would call Steve and Linda wealthy. But behind that front door, what you see on the outside isn't necessarily reality. In fact, one wrong turn, and Steve and Linda could steer their very comfortable lifestyle right off a cliff. So MoneyTrack came to their beautiful home in Cape Cod to help them navigate their way.
Hi, Linda and Steve. How are you? Nice to see you.
Hi. How are
you? Good.
Well, I'm 58 years old, having an interesting time at this part of my life. 6 years ago, we moved down to this part of Cape Cod, and we're really enjoying the summer months and getting out in our boat and having a good time with all of that because we have three kids, all of whom are grown.
You all have been married now for how many years again?
36 years.
36 wonderful years.
36 years. Yes. Most of the time, they're wonderful. He's built a very fine life for us.
We have two boats. We've got a 42-foot Sea Ray Sun Dancer. It's like a floating cottage.
We have a pretty good life. Steve works very hard.
Well, I'm having a good year this year. I've been able to grow my business by pretty close to 100% over last year. So this year I'll earn around $300,000.
a salary of $300,000 a year, they should be set, right? Well, things aren't always what they seem in the numbers department.
One of the things I worry about is how long that will last. We have to prepare if it doesn't continue. The volatility of the stock market has made things very difficult to plan on.
We panicked once. There was a drop in the stock market. We totally panicked. We sold off a whole bunch of stuff. Bad, bad move.
What are you both most concerned about in terms of your future?
What I'm afraid of is we're run out of money, and I like to spend money.
We don't want to be homeless. We don't want to be a burden on our children.
Are you actually concerned that you could really become homeless?
You just see so many homeless people. You see people that are not well retired. I just don't want that to happen to us.
You know, after spending an entire day with Steve and Linda, I really started to wonder, can they keep all this going into retirement? Or are they living some kind of retirement illusion?
If you can't dream, you can't live. You need to go to the next level. A bigger boat, another house, more jewelry. That's my big payoff. A little bling.
Okay, so they like to spend and spend, but what I'm learning here is that they've never seriously crunched the numbers to make sure they can continue to afford all this. Ironically, Steve was a math major in college. The couple also gets investing advice from two financial advisors. Yet here they are, all over the map. So now the real work begins. We brought in a financial expert, Jason Lilly, to help Steve and Linda.
So retirement is going to be the traditional retirement, which is age 65. In terms of the United States population, you're probably in the top 5% in terms of wage earners. So that's very, very good. Let's talk a little bit about spending, okay? You have a pretty good idea of what your monthly expenses currently average.
We're spending probably between $8,000 and $10,000 a month right now.
What's it cost to maintain the big boat?
Well, it depends. That's with or without gas.
So from there, they went on to answer other tough questions. How much is in their cash reserves? What's in their retirement savings accounts? In real estate, the car, the boats, the land, and income relative to spending? This one looks especially suspect.
I'm going to go back to the office and crunch some numbers.
Now they're about to have their route to retirement calculated.
Approaching left turn.
Okay, guys, it's bottom line time.
Uh-oh.
I asked you what you thought you were spending per month now. You remember what you told me?
I thought I spent between $8,000 and $10,000 a month.
It's closer to $16,000, a little bit more than that. So here's the good news. You had a net worth of about $1,500,000. You've got about 75% in stocks and about 25% in bonds. We're closer to retirement than not. So one of the things I'd encourage you is to take a look at that overall asset allocation. So you can reduce your stocks to maybe 50% stocks, 50% bonds. You make more than the typical family, you spend more than the typical family, and if you want to have a similar type of lifestyle, you need to save more than the typical family. So you're going to be about 73% funded.
So how do you get that other 27%?
If you save an extra $1,500 a month, that will get you pretty close.
Wait a minute. $1,500 a month is going to make or break this couple's retirement? Doesn't seem like all that much. But Jason says if they don't make these adjustments, they'll be out of money by the time they hit 75. That's only about halfway through their retirement. Forget boats, forget jewelry. At that point, keeping the roof over their heads would be their real issue. And they would have never known this had they not invested the time to do the simple math.
Do you think you can do it?
You have to. You have to.
I think we'll be able to do it.
You have arrived.
You know, Pam, I have a good feeling about these two. I actually think they'll do it. Half the battle is already won because now they know actually where they stand.
Plus, now they realize there's a sort of a spending speeding limit that they have to obey. Now, I met Steve and Linda. They are both smart. They're both on board. And it does take two, you know.
But you know what I'm thinking of doing just to help them out? I'm thinking I'm going to take their boat off their hands for a couple of days, maybe a week, 10 days, 2 weeks, a month during the summer, just so they'll see what it's like if they don't kind of follow the plan.
Very
helpful.
You know, most people do not make $300,000 a year. We shared Steve and Linda's very personal story with you to prove a point. If this wealthy couple's retirement years could be threatened that easily by overspending,
then those of us who don't make 300 grand a year probably need to take the whole planning process a lot more seriously. I don't know about you, but I would rather know sooner rather than later that I'm way off track.
Yeah, it's true. Having a retirement plan together 5 years before you're going to quit working, it's kind of like an early warning system. And here are three of the very first steps that are going to help you jumpstart your own retirement plan. Number one, do what you saw Jason and Lily do with Steve and Linda. He asked him to sit down and describe what their retirement life is going to look like. The boating, the traveling, and then together they figured out what that lifestyle is going to cost them per year to maintain.
In other words, create a budget that's based on this vision you have, which is obviously just an estimate.
But it's a great starting point because now we have to figure out how we're going to pay those future bills. So step two, let's find out what we have to work with now. So gather all your most recent investment, 401k, IRA, and bank statements, and then grab your credit card and mortgage statements. Even last year's tax return is going to tell you a lot. Now, what if you find out if you've got some spending surprises in there somewhere? Then you're going to know what you own and what you owe. So step three is to subtract your debts from your assets, and this is going to tell you where you stand. In other words, your current real net worth and what you have to work with. Now, if or when you find out that you are going to run out of money at some point in the future, like Steve and Linda, this is going to show you how much more you're going to need and when you're going to need it, because you do want to know, right?
Yes. Yes, I want to know. And let's face it, most of us are going to have gaps. The question is, how do you find the money to make up the shortage?
That's right. And where do you find it? Well, fortunately, on every episode of Money Track, we invite a well-known expert to be a guest professor for what we like to call Investing 101.
Today, author and retirement expert Jonathan Pond is with us. He wrote the book. In fact, he wrote several books on the process of retirement planning and how to make sure you don't run out of money.
Well, John, creating the whole plan just seems like a daunting task. I mean, there are so many things out of our control. Mm-hmm. Interest rates, they're either going to help or hurt us later on. The stock market's going to take its occasional swan dive. But when you do see that you are going to fall short, what can you do aside from spend less?
Baby boomers, interestingly enough, want to relocate. Often they want to relocate to lower cost locales. Anybody who lives on either coast, the Northeast or the West Coast, moving to the Sun Belt can reduce your living expenses by up to 40%.
So things we can do to generate money for retirement are trim the spending before you retire, like Steve and Linda, and up the savings, maybe consider downsizing to a smaller house in a less expensive community later on.
Now, John, what about just postponing retirement?
Now, that's an excellent question. Say, instead of retiring at 62, what if someone, say, like Pam here, works until she's 65 or even longer? How's that going to help her financially?
Work an extra 3 years, and it'll increase your lifetime income by 25%. Work an extra 5 years, it will increase your lifetime income by anywhere from 40 to 60%. By delaying retirement by 6 years, her lifetime income is increased by 84%.
Okay, so now I need the math lesson. Can you walk us through that last one?
Well, two things. Six more years, more contributions, more opportunity for the money to grow rather than start to withdraw the money.
See? Now, aren't you glad I asked for you?
Don't look at me. I'm hoping to retire in another 47 years when I'm 80.
Wait a minute. I'm no math major here, but if you're 13, you shouldn't be driving the car. Hey, something else that can help create more money later, we need to all pay more attention to how we invest.
Exactly. Now, since we cannot control the direction of the stock market, what can we learn from history, John?
I looked at every recession since World War II. And in the year the recession ended, stocks made double-digit returns. And in the year after the recession ended, stocks made, with one exception, made double-digit returns again. The other exception, it only made 9%.
Well, now that is good news.
Those are stats I'm going to keep handy for a rainy day. The fact is, though, we have to come up with some kind of an investment mix that's going to both produce income and still grow our savings. What's your formula?
I think the best diversification for pre-retirees is 60% stocks and 40% interest-earning securities. That's what studies have shown to be a great way to balance risk with getting decent returns.
You know, I'm going to agree, but I'm also going to go on record here to say that I am not a big fan of generalizing. When it comes to mapping out a realistic retirement plan, the devil's in the details. The point is to use this formula as a rule of thumb.
Yeah, and by the way, this grand plan has to be tweaked every year if you want to stay on track. So, I know what I'm going to be doing this weekend. Forget the boating. I'm going to have a lot more fun filling in little numbers online. John, we have about 30 seconds. What else struck you about the Adams or their lifestyle?
Well, the one thing the Adams have, which I haven't seen before, is that dog seat for their Gucci dog.
I forgot about that. We didn't show that.
Well, thank you, John. Jonathan Pond, everybody, retirement expert and dog seat connoisseur. And don't worry, I have a feeling that Pam's got her own ideas that are frankly going to make that car seat look like last year's members-only jacket.
I would never spoil my dog.
Oh, it's out of the question.
This is a really good time to let everybody know that we have all the retirement planning calculators and links right on our website.
And that's moneytrack.org, not .com. We are .org because we're organized.
Let's hear from a viewer right now who has a question about something he saw with Steve and Linda. Sam is right over there in San Francisco.
Hey, Pam and Jack. That couple you just showed, they have two financial advisors?
Yes, they have two advisors. That's right.
Yeah.
Well, I'm a paramedic, and I'm thinking about taking some of the steps that John Pond was just talking about. But my real question is, do I even need a financial advisor to plan my own retirement?
Such a great question, Sam, because this is a process, and I think that having an advisor can be a big help. But what really works here is to use that advisor more like a retirement planning coach.
As opposed to, say, a guru.
That's it. See, financial advisors, planners, they're just like anybody else. They can be super helpful, but it's best if you're involved in the process. If you simply hand over all the controls because you feel like they're the experts, not you, then you're putting your entire future in somebody else's hands.
Yeah, Sam, Steve and Linda actively participated in Jason's planning process, and going forward, they'll probably go back to their own advisors, but I'm willing to bet you that they're going to take a little more ownership this time. Now, switching gears a little bit. Anyone well into their 60s, 70s, and beyond needs to do two things. Protect their investments and make them last as long as possible.
Because now older Americans have become the number one targets for scam artists who pose as investment professionals.
When Joan Dubois relocated to Florida to build her dream house, she looked forward to a well-earned and well-funded retirement.
I like living in Sarasota. It's a great place.
Now 82 years old, Joan had lived and worked in Michigan for 40 years as an office manager for an interior design firm.
I had finished just sweeping up the snow, and when I saw how the weather was here, I thought, I'm going to move.
Joan had tucked away all the money she'd ever need to retire comfortably. She was confident in her secured investments, and Joan always did her homework and kept careful track of her money. Until one day, a tempting offer in the local Sarasota paper caught her eye. The ad promised low risk, high returns from an investment company called AmeriFirst.
The ads were in the paper every day. They were giving a very good return on the money.
Joan knew it all sounded too good to be true, but she had to see for herself. So she called and made an appointment with AmeriFirst. She visited their posh offices and met with slick-talking representative Vince Bazemore. He said all the right things, and his so-called financial savvy gave Joan the confidence she needed to invest more than $50,000.
He convinced me absolutely that this... I never for a moment did I think that there was any fraud here. He thoroughly convinced me. He had a beautiful office, had his pictures of his kids around the office. It was very nice. I was very impressed with the whole thing. He was just utterly charming.
The deception rippled throughout Florida communities, packed with retirees and snowbirds looking to live out their retirement dreams. Sadly, a lot of them took the bait.
Detective Jack Carter investigates these scams and their masterminds every day.
These are individuals who have sociopathic personalities. They're very charismatic. They could sell ice cubes to an Eskimo. They lull them in, they introduce them to one scheme where they take an initial investment, and then they'll come back and get the rest.
But the scheme began to unravel. Sarasota Herald Times reporter Tom Bales was tipped off when several people began to call about their troubles with AmeriFirst.
It starts with a phone call to the newsroom. And then there's two calls, and there's three calls, and then all of a sudden you realize there's something going on out there.
Joan, too, became suspicious.
I read it in the Sarasota Herald Tribune. My husband saw it, first of all, and so both of us, we went down to see Mr. Bazemore. And he assured me that we had nothing to worry about.
It turns out Joan wasn't the only victim. State and federal investigators estimate that approximately 380 unsuspecting Florida investors, mostly elderly, was scammed out of at least $35 million. And remember when we said AmeriFirst was an investment company? It turns out they're not even close. AmeriFirst claimed to be protected by the FDIC. That's false. They also claim to be backed by Lloyd's of London. That's not true either. AmeriFirst even went so far as to set up offices inside a bank building so it would appear as if they were somehow affiliated.
These gentlemen were extremely creative. I've covered a lot of these stories, and few were more complex. How they hid the money, how they moved the money, who saved the money. The scammers were scamming other scammers.
So, what about the $35 million? Well, Bazemore and his cronies treated themselves to fancy cars, boats, and beachfront property, all bought with the money they scammed from people. It comes down to robbing Peter to pay Paul. AmeriFirst recruited new customers and used that money to pay current clients their dividend checks, which appeared to be a return on investment. But they also advised clients to reinvest those dividends back into AmeriFirst.
And for the first, I think it was 10 months, you know, I received my interest every month.
Of course, when everything started falling apart and the federal regulators seized those bank accounts, and of course the checks stopped.
I didn't get my check for August. And I didn't get it for September, so I knew there was something wrong.
As is usually the case in a Ponzi scheme like this one, the AmeriFirst executives just disappeared overnight. Bazemore fled to Texas, where he was later apprehended by the Securities Exchange Commission. In the end, hundreds of fraud victims lost everything. Joan admits that her lifestyle has changed significantly from the ordeal, but she has weathered the storm, even though she learned a difficult lesson.
I just won't let it happen again. I promise.
Now again, Joan Dubois is one smart woman. If this could happen to her, it could happen to anybody, you or even your parents. Okay, what's going on over here? You two
resting
look pretty
up for
comfortable.
The big finish, Pam.
You know, lots of people are closing in on retirement. You know, they've reached a certain age. You know that age, Jack? Retirement age.
What are you saying?
Hey, Jack.
I'm fine. Might need a little help getting out of the chair later on. Now, Pam has a habit of checking in with celebrities to find out what celebrities are doing. Charo has been on her mind.
That's because she's hit that certain age. Take a look.
Look at her go. How about that?
Oh, is that fun? Look at her.
That's all I'm saying.
There's my
Very
girl.
Very impressive.
All right. Well, it is that time. The end of every MoneyTrack episode where we recap what we've learned.
So, show me a checklist. Number one, we learned from watching Steve and Linda that retirement planning is a very important process. And if you're going to have two financial planners on staff, make sure you check in every now and then with at least one of them.
Number two, you can't predict your future. Your retirement plan is going to have to be based on the most realistic estimates you can come up with. So the more details you have now to plug in, the more accurate your plan is going to be.
And lots of things are out of your control, but one thing you can control is your response to any offer that involves investing your money. The best way to check out any investment pitch is through your state securities regulator's office. We have the links right on our website, as well as great tips for finding financial advisors.
Well, that's our show for today, and we really want to wish Steve, Linda, and Joan the very best going forward.
And we want to thank them for sharing their stories with all of us.
Absolutely.
Chloe looks like she's ready for a walk.
And Jack looks like he's ready for a boat ride.
Jack would like that.
That's our show. Bye, everybody.
You're...
You want to go?
Yes.
Do you need some help getting up?
I do.
You do?
Well, I want to...
Chilly now, though.
Look, I told you people lived here.
We really live here.
I know it.
Don't you want to go for a boat ride?
Yes.
Step two, let's find out what we have.
Hang on for a second, I think my ride's here.
A 3-hour tour.